who ignited the national hysteria known as Hulkamania, roared through professional wrestling like a Florida hurricane.
All of a sudden, here's this big guy, 6'7", 320 pounds, with a great body, with the blonde hair and a lot of charisma. That was professional wrestling.
But Hulk Hogan didn't stop there. He became a crossover media star and a merchandising machine.
There's only going to be one Hulk Hogan. I hope there's not going to be any more than that.
In the next hour, in a no-holds-barred interview, we'll meet the man who sports what he calls 24-inch pythons, the man who revolutionized wrestling.
When I came into Madison Square Garden, played the Eye of the Tiger music, the first time any wrestler had music for an entrance, the place was electric.
We'll learn how a shy, awkward kid named Terry Bollea became Hulk Hogan, the biggest name in the business.
When Hulk Hogan came on the scene, wrestling became family entertainment.
We'll meet the men who trained him.
We showed him how to do this, you know, tell him the pose, tell him what to say.
The wrestlers who fought him.
Part of the reason Hulk Hogan is as great as he is, because he had great talent to wrestle with. Yes.
And the woman who conquered him.
I would be the one that was behind the scenes, just giving him my input.
We'll examine the controversy that threatened to bring wrestling down.
Vince McMahon was the target of the investigation. And they picked the biggest name in wrestling, Hulk Hogan, to make an example of.
We'll give you a backstage pass to the bizarre and often violent soap opera that is pro wrestling.
It's a pretty cutthroat business. You know, you gotta watch your back.
And finally, we'll see the many sides of the man known as the Hulkster.
The only new.
From hero to villain and back again.
The temperature is right now with wrestling fans to have their hero back.
In a brutal world where giants roam and mayhem reigns, one man stands alone. This is his story, Hulk Hogan, the E! True Hollywood Story. Born Terry Jean Bollea on August 11, 1953, in Atlanta, Georgia. Terry's mother, Ruth Bollea,
was such a big boy, he was over 10 pounds.
In 1955, Terry's parents, Pete and Ruth Bollea, packed up their young son and his older half-brother, Kenneth. The family moved to Tampa, Florida. Pete found work in the booming construction industry while his young boys raised hell. In 1959, pudgy six-year-old Terry started school, but the experience was a real drag.
I sat next to a girl in first grade the very first day, and she looked at me when I sat next to her, and she goes, "Has your head always been that large?" I mean, it upset me so bad, and I was so scared the first day of school that I started crying. Being fat and having the head that was bigger than all the other kids always stuck with me.
From that point on, Terry decided he was not going to be the school chump, and nobody fooled with a wrestler. Young Terry dragged his father to the local armory to watch wrestling matches. Friend Ed Leslie was also awed by the huge gladiators with bad haircuts and worse dispositions.
Oh, it was a little teeny, little hot building, and crammed in there and watched wrestling shows, and I'd be hung enough trying to get in the corner to get an autograph, and Terry thought he'd be down there at ringside, you know.
11-year-old Terry became transfixed with the over-the-top maneuvers and staged theatrics of professional wrestling.
Oh my God, I'd love to be a wrestler, but I was so intimidated. There was so much of mystique of these wrestlers, like they were these gods.
The gods, it seemed, were in Terry's corner. He grew like a weed. Friend Vic Pettit.
I know he's like 6 foot, 200 pounds when he was 12. So he was always the giant on the block for his age.
In 1966, 13-year-old Terry was the star player on his little league team. And at nearly 200 pounds, he intimidated everybody.
He used to hit the ball so far, everybody used to protest the games or anything, because they always said, he's too big, he shouldn't be allowed to play with all the rest of the kids.
Terry's potential seemed limitless, until he suffered a freak injury. Little League coach Lou Garcia.
He made a throw from third base and broke his arm, and I guess that discouraged him. As far as I know, he never played ball again.
In 1968, Terry entered Robinson High School in Tampa. The football coach took one look and immediately tried to lure Terry onto the gridiron. But the gentle giant had other plans.
I'd always play guitar and take music lessons, so got together with a little rock and roll band in high school. It was kind of tough because as I was going to high school, I was playing in a band that was basically working until like 2 o'clock in the morning.
By his senior year in 1971, 18-year-old Terry had more on his mind than music.
Right before I got out of high school, I started lifting weights because I started getting real girl conscious and wanted to get in shape instead of not being able to take my shirt off on the beach.
Terry bulked up while still holding on to his dream of becoming a professional wrestler. But following graduation in 1971, he took a more practical route.
I went to Hillsborough Community College for 2 years, got the liberal arts degree. And I went to the University of South Florida for a couple of years, trying to major in finance and business and be a banker.
A 6'7", 280-pound loan officer would certainly discourage bad debts, but Terry Bollea still dreamed of wrestling.
I started kind of like being a stalker. I knew where the local wrestlers would eat, and I knew when they were going to wrestle and what hotels they stayed in. And I finally got up enough nerve to ask a wrestler, how do you get into wrestling? And he basically pointed me into the direction of Hiro Matsuda.
Matsuda, a Japanese wrestler from the old school, ran a training center in Tampa. 23-year-old Terry soon found out that in Matsuda's gym, arrogance was never tolerated.
I basically went down there and I told people in Tampa, I'm going to be a wrestler. So when I went down there, they were laying low, they were waiting for me. So they exercised me until I was about to puke and got me in the ring and stretched me. And finally, when I was totally out of it, pretty much all washed up, Matsuda sat down between my legs, posted my shin, pulled up on my toe, and broke my ankle.
It was a painful lesson that would have discouraged most men, but most men weren't Terry Bollea. Coming up, Terry gets the offer of a lifetime.
I got like this Western Union certified letter that said Sylvester Stallone urgently needs to talk to you about this part.
Terry Bollea, who would soon be known to the world as Hulk Hogan, was a big kid who grew into a giant of a man. By 1976, the 23-year-old was a towering 6'7" tall and weighed 280 pounds. His dream was to be a professional wrestler, and he certainly had the goods, but a broken ankle nearly stopped Hulk Hogan in his tracks.
I got my ankle fixed, stayed away about 10 weeks, but this time I came back to Matsuda's gym with a different attitude.
From 1976 through 1977, Terry Bollea lived with his parents in Tampa, Florida, and trained under Hiro Matsuda, a rugged taskmaster. Friend Brad Rangans.
That camp was considered probably one of the most demanding, probably one of the most dangerous wrestling camps that you could, schools that you could participate in.
In October 1979, Bollea made his wrestling debut.
They called me the Super Destroyer. All I knew was to eat people up and destroy. I'd been taught to be this killer in Matsuda's school. And basically, when I got in the ring, the guy was, hey, take it easy, take it easy.
Bollea continued to wrestle near his Florida home, but the lure of the road beckoned.
If I was ever going to make it, I had to leave. So I got in my van and drove up to Alabama.
Terry joined the Northern Wrestling Alliance circuit, driving from match to match, living hand to mouth.
A good friend of mine, Ed Leslie, who later became Brutus the Barber Beefcake, was with me from day one. And for the first couple of years, we had this van, and I slept on the floor of the van, and he slept in the back.
The schedule was exhausting, the matches barbaric, the crowds bloodthirsty. Family and friends were shocked by Terry's transformation.
The first time that he gave an interview, and I heard him yeah, mouthing off, I said, Peter, come here and look at this. I can't believe Terry, because I've never seen him like that.
Anything that you can do, I can do better. I'm going to show you right now.
Wrestling had gotten under Terry's skin, but he was paying a terrible price.
There was a lot of tugging and pulling and, you know, broken bones and a lot of sucker punches and teeth chipped and knocked out and, you know, nose being broke 5 or 6 times.
Despite the severe beatings, Terry was determined to make it as a pro wrestler. In 1980, at age 27, Bollea headed to Memphis, Tennessee, where the wrestling scene made his days in Alabama and Florida seem tame.
They were into all the gimmicks of, you know, the loser leave town match, or shave the wrestler's wife's head if you lose, and I started to learn a little bit of the art of the show business stuff there, and all the wrestlers. Let's say there's a TV show on called The Incredible Hulk, and Lou Ferrigno's a star, but you're bigger than him. And I became Terry the Hulk Boulder there.
Even with two name changes, Bollea's career was caught in a hammerlock.
After I wrestled 12 or 14 times, I'd get a check for like $125. And you really couldn't afford to buy food or gas or pay for a hotel room with that, so that didn't last very long. And I quit wrestling, came back to Florida, worked on the docks as a longshoreman, loading ships.
The work was backbreaking, but the money was good. Still, Terry's heart was in the ring, and in 1981, fate intervened.
A guy named Terry Funk came down to Florida, and he says, "What's wrong with you, man? You're gonna have a great career. Why'd you quit wrestling?" I said, "Man, I just can't make it. It's too tough." And Terry Funk says, "Well, there's a guy in New York you need to talk to."
That guy was 62-year-old Vince McMahon Sr., head of the World Wrestling Federation, a longtime powerhouse in the Northeast. McMahon recognized Terry's enormous potential and immediately brought him into the WWF.
Vince McMahon Sr. loved the name The Hulk, but he said, "I want you to be Hogan, an Irishman." And he gave me a couple bottles of this red dye, and I said, "You know, my hair is already falling out." So I actually poured the red dye down the toilet, and they let Hulk Hogan be a blonde-haired Irishman.
In the early 1980s, pro wrestling was dominated by the Crusher, Dick the Bruiser, and the reigning King of the Ring, Andre the Giant. Nobody messed with Andre, and newly christened Hulk Hogan soon found out why.
Andre was 7'4", so he went from 550 pounds to 700 pounds, depending on what his diet was. Andre and I started off on the wrong foot. I was young and aggressive and basically didn't have a lot of respect and didn't understand what this business was all about, so I thought I could conquer all. Andre put in the rough stop to that and re-educated me, basically by embarrassing me, showing that he was 100 times stronger than me.
But Hulk learned fast, and he soon became a major draw on the WWF circuit. Then in 1981, following a match in New York's Madison Square Garden, Hogan was approached by an agent with a note and an improbable line.
Sylvester Stallone wants for a movie, all right. And I threw it away because at the time they had Rocky I and Rocky II, and Sylvester Stallone was like 100 feet tall in the public's eyes.
Hulk didn't give the idea a second thought. A few months later, the 24-year-old grappler left on a wrestling tour of Japan, where he dazzled the more sedate Asian crowds with skill versus showmanship.
I've seen him go from here over to Tokyo, wrestle in the Tokyo Dome, and see a very technical Hulk Hogan.
But it was Hogan's size and strength that captivated Japanese fans and crippled hometown heroes like Antonio Inoki.
I go outside, he give me Axe Bomber and outside. I fall down, I knock out, and I don't remember nothing.
A shot at fame was dropped in Hulk's lap after returning to the United States in the fall of 1981.
I got like this Western Union certified letter that said Sylvester Stallone urgently needs to talk to you about this part. Oh my God, maybe this is real. So I called the number, and it was Sylvester's home number. And I talked to him on the phone, and he says, "Yeah, I'd love to have you for the movie."
The film was Rocky III. And Hulk was offered the role of, what else, a wrestler. The character's name was Thunderlips, but Jerry was still obligated to Vince McMahon and the WWF.
When I told Vince McMahon Sr., that I had a chance to do a movie, he said, "You're not an actor, you're a wrestler. You're not allowed to do the movie." I said, "Well, I'm sorry, I'm doing the Rocky movie." Vince McMahon Sr. says, "Well, you're fired and don't ever call here again."
Hulk Hogan packed his bags and headed for Hollywood. Coming up, the Titan from Tampa takes on the Italian Stallion.
When I hit him in the back as hard as I could, his face hit my boots immediately.
In 1981, 28-year-old Hulk Hogan was booted from the World Wrestling Federation for breaking ranks to appear in Rocky III. The movie, starring Sylvester Stallone, changed the face of wrestling and the life of Hulk Hogan forever.
She saw the Rocky movie, but she thought I was just an actor.
In November 1981, Hulk Hogan showed up for work on the set of Rocky III in Los Angeles.
Well, being on the set of Rocky III was probably one of the greatest things as far as a break in my career. Stallone made it really believable because he did all his own stunts. And even when I hit him, you know, he told me to hit him as hard as I would a normal wrestler, so I really unloaded on him. He loved it.
Hulk finished filming the movie in December and wanted to return to the wrestling ring.
I'd sent pictures in 8x10s from the Rocky movie, which wasn't even released yet, to Minneapolis to a promoter named Vern Gagne. He saw me standing next to Stallone, and he knew instantly that there were dollar signs there, so he called me up and said, please come right away to the Minneapolis area because I want to have you wrestle here.
Vern Gagne's American Wrestling Association controlled the Midwest region of the U.S. Gagne, a former world champion, was famous for finishing off his opponents with a sleeper hold in and out of the ring. Gagne made a point to prove that the wrestling action was real, even though the results were scripted.
Vern Gagne was very hard-headed, and anybody questioned him on the validity of wrestling, he would be more than happy to take them down and make them scream for their life and wrestle them on the floor or anywhere.
Hogan arrived in Minnesota in March 1982. According to Gagne, when the blonde bomber was tested in the ring, the results were mixed.
Not too good. Not very good. But we showed him how to do this, you know, tell him to pose, tell him what to say. Me and Gene, you ask him this, and Hogan, you say this.
Former AWA announcer Gene Okerlund.
We have an expression in this business. Hulk Hogan was very green. Both in interviews, of which we would do 18 or 20 takes. I know because I had to do all 18 or 20.
Mean Gene, I'm tired. I'm tired of being on the receiving end all the time.
And his work in the ring, not from what I saw, but from what other guys would say, was also a little marginal.
While Mean Gene helped with the interviews, Vern Gagne and his son Greg carefully molded their fast rising star.
They taught me a lot about how to be Hulk Hogan and how to be this big, big character that was larger than life.
That became an understatement when the Hulk hit movie screens. In June 1982, Rocky III opened nationwide, pitting Hogan as Thunderlips against Rocky Balboa.
Thunderlips is here! In the flesh, baby!
Rocky III was a hit. Wrestlers suddenly became more than villains in tights, and Hulkamania began to take hold.
Because Hulkamania's running wild.
When the matches ended, the nightlife began, and Hulk Hogan cut loose.
I was still the redneck, still the beer drinker, still the Hellraiser, you know, behind the scenes.
In September 1982, Hulk began to change his hell-raising ways. At a Los Angeles disco, Hogan caught the eye of Linda Claridge, a 21-year-old manicurist from Northridge, California.
I went over to say hi, and he had a whole little fortress of women all around him, and I went, oh, forget it.
All of a sudden, I looked over, and one of my friends that I went to high school was talking to Linda, and I kind of nudged in on the conversation, and she kind of blew me off, I guess.
Throughout the rest of the night, he kept trying to pursue me, and we ended up talking, and I thought he was very nice. I thought he was very gentlemanlike, very different from how he seemed.
The mutual attraction was complicated by logistics. Linda lived in Los Angeles. Hulk lived in Minneapolis. Hogan charged ahead anyway.
He called me for 2 solid weeks until we could figure out how to get together. And our first date was actually in Denver, Colorado. He flew me to a wrestling match in Denver, Colorado.
Linda Claridge had never been to a wrestling match in her life. And suddenly, she was dating the main event. The experience was an eye-opener.
There was blood, and he was banging his head on the ring post, and I just remember looking at the fans trying to see, you know, are they going to call an ambulance or something? And they were into it. They were all, like, cheering for more. I was taking the whole thing in. It was very, very weird. Seeing him then after the match, I just thought to myself, is this what I want? What am I doing? The interest, I think, was overwhelming, and I was just so curious. I just continued to keep seeing him however we could.
Terry spent weeks traveling the back roads of the Midwest as the star attraction for Vern Gagne's American Wrestling Association. Gagne's colorful stable of wrestlers included Mad Dog Vachon and a former Navy SEAL who was destined for even greater fame outside the ring.
Wait, have you checked out the lateral deltoid lately?
The lateral deltoid?
Check that out.
Well, it's kind of like a Jesse Ventura fan. I got there and Jesse, his homeboy Minneapolis, pro Minneapolis all the way. And at the time, we'd become pretty good friends.
Hogan and Ventura wrestled each other many times and became a popular matchup.
They saw that I was bigger than Jesse, and they just wanted me to kick Jesse's rear end.
You could not beat me. You could not even beat Sylvester Stallone in the movie Rocky III. It was a draw. I'd have squashed that peanut in 30 seconds.
Coming up, Hulk Hogan pile drives his old mentor.
Vern was very aggressive. He was just very mean. And I just didn't want to work under those conditions.
Part sexual prophet.
Penthouse.
Big city arenas. Along the way, Hogan tore opponents limb from limb and landed a feature film role opposite Sylvester Stallone. By January 1983, Hogan was the American Wrestling Association's biggest attraction, and Hulk was just warming up.
Things were going great in Minneapolis. I was at all the main events, but Vince McMahon made me an offer that I couldn't refuse.
The buzz created by Rocky III propelled Hulk Hogan into the national spotlight. Former AWA announcer Ken Resnick.
Hulk really was the first wrestler that transcended wrestling. He was a wrestler. He was an entertainer. He was a movie star. I mean, it was like he was a rock and roll star.
Hulk Hogan and the AWA seemed unstoppable. Then, in the fall of 1983, while preparing for a match in Chicago, Hogan's career took an unexpected turn.
This photographer named Steve Taylor handed me a card and said, please call Vince McMahon immediately.
Vince McMahon fired Hogan in 1981 for appearing in Rocky III, but this message was from his son, Vince McMahon Jr.
Vince Jr. had told me he was taking over the business and that his father was going to graciously move aside. And that instead of being a very territorial business, Vince McMahon was going to take over the whole world. Well, he said, I want to do it with you.
While Hogan considered McMahon's offer, Hulk made an offer of his own to his girlfriend, Linda.
He flew me to San Francisco. I watched the match afterwards, went right back to the hotel room, and he was being very weird. And he said, I know that I said that we needed to live together first, but I've been doing a lot of thinking, and I didn't realize that he had now gotten down onto one knee. And he was holding my hand, and he just looked at me in the eye, and he said, Linda, I love you, and I want to marry you. Will you marry me? I just started to cry, and it was really neat, and I said yes.
Hulk Hogan and Linda Claridge were married in Hollywood, California on December 18, 1983.
As far as the people that he invited, it was really interesting. We had Andre the Giant. We had a whole Japanese film crew there, various wrestlers. It was really exciting because it was just people that you wouldn't expect to see at your normal wedding.
After their honeymoon, Terry and Linda returned to Minneapolis, where Hogan continued to perform with the American Wrestling Association. Meanwhile, WWF promoter Vince McMahon Jr. turned up the heat.
He said, I can make you a bigger star, that you'll be Hulk Hogan, and we'll draw money everywhere. I like the idea.
But Hogan still had unfinished business with his boss, Vern Gagne. In December, Gagne set up a match between Hulk Hogan and Nick Bockwinkel for the AWA title. It was Gagne's job to decide the outcomes of wrestling matches. But on this night, Hogan made the decision for him.
When I was in the dressing room, Vern Gagne came in and he said, you're going to win the belt tonight. And it was right before my transition back to New York. He says, but when you win the belt, you're going to give me a certain percentage of your money. And also your Japan deal, because you're going back and forth to Japan, you're going to give me a percentage of your money there too. So I'm not interested. I don't need your belt. I don't want your belt.
Hogan left the AWA and joined Vince McMahon Jr. in the World Wrestling Federation. On January 24, 1984, Hulk Hogan made his WWF debut.
When I came into Madison Square Garden, played the Eye of the Tiger music, the first time any wrestler had music for an entrance. Won the WWF title in Madison Square Garden, and from that day on, wrestling would change from just a hardcore beer drinker, cigar smoking sport to sports entertainment.
Coming up, a legendary giant takes a fall.
Yes, we get in the ring tonight. You go up tonight. I pass the torch to you.
Into uncharted territory, the WWF produced WrestleMania, a star-studded gala with a blockbuster card.
It was a high because we had all the major stars, our Ali, Cyndi Lauper, Liberace, and I knew we were on something really big.
WrestleMania was the first live wrestling card ever shown on closed-circuit television, the forerunner to pay-per-view events. Vince McMahon Jr. was off and running.
He was the promoting machine. I went out and did the wrestling, and Vince McMahon sat in his office and did the deals.
Hogan's hard work and McMahon's hype were a dynamic combination. On March 29, 1987, 94,000 wrestling fans filled the Pontiac Silverdome near Detroit for WrestleMania III. The event set an indoor attendance record and was the backdrop for Hogan's greatest victory. The night's main event pitted 33-year-old Hulk Hogan against the legendary Andre the Giant. At 7'4" and 600 pounds, Andre was 40 years old and in the twilight of his career.
Andre wouldn't talk to us. He wouldn't tell us what he was going to do or what, you know, was going to happen. He was getting older. His health was bad.
Bobby the Brain Heenan was Andre's manager.
93,000 people. Indoor attendance record. And I asked Andre Knight, I said, what's going to happen, boss? Don't worry. Bobby told me.
And that night we sat in the dressing room. Before the match was started, and Andre said, boss, sit down. He goes, we get in the ring tonight. You go up. So we got in the ring and we wrestled. He was in a lot of pain and we got through the match and right when we got ready to what we called go home, which means end the match. Andre goes, go home. So I said, okay. And he goes, body slam me. I said, what? He goes, body slam me.
I saw Hogan pick him up and get him to here. And I shut my eyes and then I heard him hit. I never saw him turn. I couldn't believe it, because Andre had never been off his feet.
I picked him up, I got him halfway up, and he was so heavy when I went to turn him. I felt every muscle in my back tear, like my whole lat. I fell down to my waist and tore every muscle into my arm. I slammed in, 94,000 people went crazy.
Crazy turned to hysteria when Hulk pinned Andre for the three count.
Andre the Giant made the name Hulk Hogan history that night. And I realized what he'd done, you know.
Hulk tested his popularity out of the ring in 1989 when he starred in the feature film No Holds Barred, a wrestling movie with co-star Joan Severance.
I was a big wrestling fan and I didn't know much about him except that he had a doll because I had seen the doll. And at our read-through, and you know, I shook his hand. And his hand is like the size of my hips, 36 inches big, and I felt like olive oil.
No Holds Barred was panned by the critics, and future films like 1990's Suburban Commando and Mr. Nanny received similar reviews.
I always dreamed of having that big breakthrough film and become just as big and body slam Hollywood, just like I did the wrestling business, but it never really happened.
As the World Wrestling Federation entered the 1990s, Hulk Hogan continued to star in Vince McMahon's ongoing soap opera, losing his title numerous times only to win it back in dramatic fashion. But living up to the superstar image became a burden for Hogan and his wife, Linda.
It got to the point where he finally was on his way. You know, Hulk Hogan was very established and he was doing very well. And I woke up one day and I thought, you know, I'm really tired.
Didn't have the spark in my eye that I had before. I needed a break.
Wrestling's biggest star was burning out, and WWF owner Vince McMahon Jr. began to look for his new Hulk Hogan.
She tried several times to pass the torch, like to the Ultimate Warrior who beat me. And when she put the belt on the Ultimate Warrior, he was one-dimensional and didn't last very long. They had to put the belt back on me to keep things going.
In early 1992, McMahon was indicted by a federal grand jury on allegations of illegally distributing steroids to his wrestlers. The use of steroids, once the staple of many athletes, was outlawed in 1991.
If Vince McMahon went to jail, then every one of us in the wrestling business should have went to jail because we did the same thing Vince did. We experimented with steroids and used them. But in the wrestling business, along with the baseball and football, steroids were used across the board. and it was real easy to go to a doctor and get a prescription for him because they were legal.
Rumors of rampant steroid use began to tarnish Hulk Hogan's image, and the 38-year-old champion decided it was time to retire. In one of his final matches for the World Wrestling Federation, Hulk Hogan appeared at WrestleMania 8 in Las Vegas on April 5th, 1992.
I just got hit in the face with a jet ski a couple days before, and I was almost lost this eye. I went to Las Vegas to wrestle at the pay-per-view, and I had 100-something stitches in my face, and I couldn't see out of my eye. Probably was the craziest thing I've ever done, and I actually wrestled with my whole orbital socket crushed and broken.
The absurdity of the situation was apparent to the battered champion. After the match, Hulk Hogan quietly retired from professional wrestling in the summer of 1992. Coming up, Hulk Hogan and Vince McMahon face off in court.
Basically, I was the star witness, and I was the one that the whole world thought was going to put the nail in the coffin and say, Vince away for 17 years.
Steroid distribution forced the WWF owner into the fight of his life, and Hogan was caught in the middle.
You know, they put Vince through 3 or 4 years of hell, and they strategically positioned the federal government meeting against Vince McMahon, which created a bunch of tension.
The trial of the United States of America versus Vince McMahon Jr. began on July 1st, 1994. It was a dark day for the World Wrestling Federation. Meanwhile, Hulk Hogan, the retired WWF champ, was hard at work on the syndicated television series Thunder in Paradise. The Hulkster played an ex-Navy SEAL with a heroic streak. Co-star Chris Lemon.
I had a great time with him. I mean, we were together for 3 years, you know, and during that time, it was like getting a new best friend. We had as much fun off the set as we did on, and he has an enormous charisma, and people, you know, just flock to him.
The series, shot at Disney's Orlando studios, freed Hogan to spend more time at his home in Tampa with wife Linda and their two children.
When we just had Brooke, he was still on the road quite a bit, and it took him some time to scale down. And then when we had Nick, I guess maybe the fact that it was his son really changed him, and he just decided to say, that's it, I just want to park it and be a dad. And he was home quite a bit for the kids.
No girl.
While Hulk enjoyed family life in Florida, Vince McMahon's troubles mounted. In the summer of 1993, media mogul Ted Turner announced he was throwing his hat and wallet in the wrestling ring. Turner planned to revamp his World Championship Wrestling franchise to compete with McMahon and the WWF. To make a big splash, Turner needed a big fish.
They started approaching me on a pretty much weekly basis. And I was pretty much done with wrestling and saved my money and made good investments and happy with my family. And they made me a deal that involved wrestling part-time, but staying on TV full-time. It was a really good package.
Hulk agreed to join World Championship Wrestling in the summer of 1994, but 2 weeks before his comeback, Hulk Hogan was slapped with a